So with the dawn of 2019, the burning issues were bubbling, especially in football. The first day of the year, football lost one of its great servants in former national football manager and President Oliver Camps. Mr. Camps, for the years that I knew him and I got to know him, served generations of footballers. Soft-spoken gentleman. But not everybody is soft-spoken and gentle. I'm not. Keith Lucloy is not. Jack Warner, certainly not. Both men, very opinionated, and have spoken out against this current administration. The politics of football is at its nastiest for the last 25 years that I have been covering football and sport here in TNT. In 2019, our football not thriving, local football not getting fans excited as it used to, both on and off the field. On the field, one of the big critics is Mr. Lucloy. Mr. Lucloy is not sure that Dennis Lawrence is the man. He has been questioning Dennis's performance over the last year. But interestingly, looking back when Mr. Lucloy was in charge and making decisions as part of the administration, our football floundering under then coach Otto Pfister, Lucloy seemed to be blaming the players and the poor performances on the field. So who's to blame? Players or the coach? Jack Warner has come out and weighed in on a number of issues and very critical of this administration as well. One of the issues is the controversial home of football that is being built by this David John Williams administration. Jack is questioning the reason for what he is calling the house of football. He said you can't kick a house in a recent interview done by Sergio Defoe here at TV6. But respectfully, I am old enough to remember Jack Warner built 5 stadia in this country. 3 of them today, not in regular use, not being maintained, lights not being able to be switched on for football games to be played. The blame game continues in local football. And while those left opposing, those right trying to execute their own agenda, and in the middle, football is failing and falling apart. Song of the whistle, it's halftime on 6.
Nobody, but nobody, can stop me ever for speaking on football matters.
Jack was in the box. Now he's made it clear that he is out. It's a new year. It's time to deal with the burning issues in sports. Halftime is back, January 16th. Listen for the sound of the whistle on 6.
Nobody, but nobody, can stop me ever for speaking on football matters.
Trinidad and Tobago's football, fighting to keep its head above water, from financial woes to coaches and players not being paid, and opposition from the other side in your face. So, where is football? We have appointed a new coach that brought a fresh sense of hope about 2 years ago. Dennis Lawrence, a national hero, the man's head that took us to Germany 2006. And believe it or not, he is taking the reins of national football and come under a lot of criticism over the last few months. Dennis Lawrence is here tonight to look back at what he's done with this national team and look ahead at the possibly what's in store for national football and for him personally. Dennis, I want to thank you very much for being here tonight.
Sure, it's a pleasure having you.
Let's start, Dennis, with... It's been January 2017.
Yep.
January 2019 now.
Yep.
So this is a good time just to reassess what has happened.
Yeah.
When you came into the job, I remember song bites such as, you're not a magician, but you're coming in to challenge what is before you.
Yeah.
What has that challenge been like for you?
It's been a fantastic challenge because why? It's football. Football is something I've been involved in for majority of my life. So I see every challenge as a fascinating thing to be involved in. I think what is important is that in the time being here, I've heard a lot about challenges and what's wrong. And I've not really heard a lot about solutions. And that's why I'm interested in solutions. And that's what I've tried to do over the last 2 years working with the team, is all I do is think about solutions and finding solutions.
Everybody knows what's wrong. But to find the solutions, as you're saying, is sometimes easier said than done. Have you been able to find solutions to fixing Trinidad Tobago's football or putting Trinidad Tobago's football on the right path?
In my domain, which is a coach, being on the grass, being interacting with the players, I've managed to find solutions to some of the things. When I took over, obviously, it was a two-tier plan because I took over right in the middle of a World Cup campaign. I wouldn't say the team was at its greatest point at that time. Confidence was a bit low, and the idea was to give Russia 2018 our best. I thought we did that in most parts. A couple of games probably we let ourselves down as a team. So I thought we did that in most parts. But going forward now, after the World Cup, we went into the next phase of the two-tier plan, which is the moment we couldn't qualify for Russia, we had to start thinking about Qatar 2022. In doing that, there's a process. And I started the process immediately, trying to interact some of the younger players and them, getting them involved, trying to have better training programs, better training and development programs. And we've managed to do that in many ways. You've alluded to a number of different things, why it's extremely difficult, why it is to put these things in place, because we all know, and it's no secret, financially we're not in a happy moment. And we need to find ways to work around that, which we've managed to do over a period of time. But every now and again, these financial issues become a challenge, and yet the challenge continues.
Yeah. Let's stay with the financial issues, because, I mean, as good as your intentions may be, as good as your problem-solving ability may be, the reality is that football is big business.
Yeah.
And to be able to just run, I suppose, just the basic elements of a national program, you would probably be found wanting. The president may tell you, well, you can't get this, you can't get that. What do Dennis Lawrence do in that case?
Yeah, these are the challenges that we face. And obviously, when I took the job, I understood that I was coming to a football association that I wasn't blessed with riches. So I had to try and be creative to find ways to work in and around the budgets that were given. And in saying that, I think we've managed to do relatively well. We've had to be creative with some of the staff members. I don't know if you look back in the initial when he started, we had Rido, the boy from South Africa who was the fitness conditioning coach. And at one point, it became a bit financially demanding and we couldn't afford it. So we had to be creative and we had to use what we had in the local staff. And we had to promote Siren to make him into the fitness conditioning coach. And we found a solution to crack, to patch that up. But in saying that, we are working towards a target which is coming out of a financial situation. And one of the things that the administration in prison believe is that by building the home of football is going to be an avenue to try and eradicate some of the financial burdens that we face at the moment.
You brought that up so early in the discussion where you're making us switch to home of football so early.
We started to talk about, you know what I mean?
So that's interesting. Yeah. I have had David John Williams on the show. He has expressed and explained his vision with regards to this home of football. Some agree, some obviously doesn't. They don't agree. You're in favor of what the president is doing with regards to the home of football?
Joel, I'll just start by saying this. I spent a number of years working in the UK, and I had the privilege of visiting some of these top countries. I went to Italy to watch Italy train. I went to Portugal to watch Portugal train. I had the opportunity to go and watch England train. And one thing I can say to you is for every training camp that I've been to, mm-hmm. I reported to the training ground or the training center. Because in modern football now, I think having your own facilities is a vital part of development, planning, and preparation. So when you think about it from that point of view, of course I support the home of football, mm-hmm. because I believe it's a way to help us develop our football and to progress. So if you don't have the vision to see why the home of football is going to be an integral part in our development, then I can't say anymore. I can only say what I've seen is done for other countries. I did most of my coaching courses in Wales. In fact, I did all my coaching courses in Wales. And we always did it at the Wales training center. Yeah. So that's where the Welsh team reports to when they've got international games. That's where they do all the preparation for training and the development programs. So for me, I think it's a vital part of what we're trying to do.
And I mean, off the top, Dennis, that sounds logically sound. Why do you think there is a sector of the football society in Trinidad and Tobago that not seeing the need or the importance for a home of football and questioning why this administration is putting so much emphasis on this home of football? Is it just based on accountability? Because that is one of the things they put forward. Where is this administration getting this money from? They're broken now, but they're building a home of football. What is the issue? Why can't football, the football fraternity in Trinidad and Tobago, agree that a home of football, or what you just described and explained, that a home of football in this country is necessary?
I think some of the people who oppose of it will have to answer that question themselves. What are their reasons? I couldn't tell you. But what I would say is that somebody has to walk up to take the penalty, and is a brave person.
Yeah.
And the person who walks up to take the penalty might not be the one to win the game in the end, because he might miss and somebody might need to come and take one behind to cover it up. So what the president has done is been the brave one to say, you know something, I've got a vision, I've got a goal, I've got a target, I see what it can do, and I'm going to be brave enough to go out and do it. And when it was explained to me what it was all about, as a footballing coach, I saw the benefits. Mm-hmm. So it's impossible for me to be negative to what I see is going to help benefit me as a coach.
Right.
So I think any footballing person that really understands what it is about, then they would support it. Mm-hmm. You mentioned from the financial side and your accountability, that is not my domain. I'm a football coach. If they've got questions about that, then they need to bring in those people to answer those questions about that aspect of it. I can only talk about what I'm seeing is going to do for our football on the football pitch.
You connected a short while ago solving financial problems to this football home. Explain.
Well, what is in plan, if it works, mm-hmm. then it's an avenue to try and generate revenue. So if these things are being said, then why not give it a go? Because we have to try and do something. And if we're going to be really, really honest with ourselves, financially, it's not just the TTFA struggling. It's a financial crisis right across the board. I attended the basketball Barry Stewart's prize ceremony just recently, and when I sat what I was hearing, I actually felt very relief, because I was thinking that we're in a bad state, but basketball is in a 10-time worse state than us.
And it means a lot, but it is.
And they're still still going.
Yeah, yeah.
So in terms of financial, it's a broad problem, mm-hmm. and somebody's doing something that they believe can find a solution. So finding a solution, of course, I would support that because I believe it is in aid to find a solution. Mm-hmm.
Sad in your view and in your mind, based on, I think, how important you think this project of creating a home of football is, sad that the general consensus among the fraternity is not in support of this?
Well, it's a strange one because from what I'm hearing, the football people, when I walk the streets, right, mm-hmm. I think they're all in support of the home of football because they understand what it can do for our football. Mm-hmm. I think maybe you got a section that is trying to send the wrong message about the home of football and they're trying to tie it into this financial accountability and all of that. It's two separate things we're talking about. Mm-hmm. If we talk about the home of football and what it can do for football, that's one thing.
Yeah.
If you want to talk about financial transparency and things, that's just something separate. But somebody's trying to tie them in together and it's causing a bit of a problem.
All right, let's get back onto the field of play. Mm-hmm. Your biggest challenge. You spoke about coming in and you knew, Dennis, you've been a player here. I remember covering a strike action by the players and you were a player. You remember that?
Well, yeah.
You guys said no water, I remember. Mm. And it's so strange. Some people feel that football problems started now. Mm. And I just want to go back. I remember and you were playing, I believe that was the era with Otis Whitley. And,
yeah.
And you guys were not getting water on training sessions and walked out and said, until we get proper things to train, we can't train.
Well,
remember that?
It those days, right, football meant a lot different to us now. We played under, when I can remember training with national team, and yeah. it was one cooler and five cups. And when it was a break in the training session, we had to line up and take our cup and wait for your turn to have a drink. Obviously, football has moved on. The game has evolved. And I don't expect things to stay that way because we didn't fight hard, myself and the ones before me in the strike squad days, for it to be the same now. But we endured some really, really enduring and tough times. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you this now, but I never went on strike at any point. Because football for me meant too much for me to walk away from it and decided I want to go on strike. Of course, I wasn't happy with certain things, but football always was the prominent thing on my mind. So now we've got in a situation where things has improved, but they haven't evolved in the way we would have liked it to evolve. So there is still tough times going ahead. And in many ways, the players themselves need to take a bit of responsibility and understand that we're not in a football association or we're not living in a country that we're blessed with everything. Now, what I can say to you, in my time in working with the players and them, I can give the players full credit because they've been fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
They've come out every training session and they've done what I've asked of them. They've given the all and they've all showed a lot of respect for each other. And one of the things that I asked the players and I demanded from the players is that when they take the football pitch, Trinidad and Tobago must see players fighting for this country. And I think the players have done that. Obviously, now situations arise and things develop, but it's going to be resolved. I'm hoping that it's going to be resolved and everything is going to be clarified and we can go back to what we're trying to do.
So you're happy with the players that you would have used over the last few years?
I'm pretty happy with the players in terms of the commitment and in terms of their attitude when they report to the national
team. So let me get back to your biggest challenge. That was my initial question. Your biggest challenge, Dennis, coming in, you knew the difficulties that you would face being in the hot seat as coach of the national team. 2 years down the road, what has been your biggest challenge?
The biggest challenge is being able to put together programs that I would like to be able to put together. Why? Because financially, it's a costly thing.
Right.
And when I do things, I want to do it correctly, right? We're not, we're not blessed with the money that was given back when people was appointing people and paying them $50,000 a month and calling it chop change. We don't have that now, right? I wish we had a bit of that chump change that we'd be able to put together programs.
And pay a cool
$50,000 because, yeah. I mean, if that was the going rate in 2010, 11.
Cool, yeah, you making at least $100,000.
Well, I wish that was the case.
Because appreciation, I mean, yeah.
Of course, you know, rice is going up, flour is going up, these things have gone up. But yet, we now no longer have this $50,000 chump change. We don't have that again.
We're in a recession.
You know, so being able to put together these programs, right, to be able to sustain what we're trying to do, it is, I'll give you one example, Joel, and people don't notice. So sometimes you need to inform people. We played Mexico. Mm-hmm. That was the second to last game of the Hex. And to get back from Mexico to Trinidad to play the USA, we came back in three different groups. It took us about 10 hours to get back. And we came back and we managed to find a solution. We tried to use the pool and the Cara Suites. We tried to recover the boys as best as possible to be able to put in a performance against a USA team that flew immediately after the game on the chartered flight, came to Trinidad because they understood what the game meant. But we were managed to find a way to come on and compete, and unfortunately enough, we got a result out of it. So the challenges are going to be there until we can find a solution to the financial strains that we face.
I know that you're hopeful that, yes, a financial solution will be on the horizon. Let's just say that in the immediate future, no financial solution is putting itself out there and say, okay, this is how we solve this problem. How does Dennis Lawrence deal with that going forward?
We roll our sleeves up and we fight, and we continue to find solutions, because it's not like we're in a situation where we can wave the magic wand and sort the financial crisis all out in one go. I wish it could happen, but it probably is not going to happen overnight. So what we need to do is continue to fight, continue to be positive, continue to be brave, and compete as best as we can until we can get ourselves in a position where we can now go, right, we're ready to take on the world. Because our preparation is reliant on being able to put together programs. Look, some of our teams, you saw with the face, our women's team, our under-20 team, whether that was the TTFA's fault, whether it was a financial fault, in the end, the players suffered. Trinidad and Tobago suffering. Those are the things that we need to make sure and get right.
Dennis Lawrence, the national football coach, is in the house this evening. And when we come back from this short break, we look at his performance on the field of play, and he breaks down what he did wrong, what he did right, and what he could improve on when we come back.
This month on Caribbean Passport, we kick off the year of activities with top tourism trends, up-and-coming events, and the latest from the region, all coming up right here on this station.
Do you suffer from pain in your back, knees, or joints, and need effective pain relief? Get your life back with Omega XL, a natural, safe, anti-inflammatory supplement. This small soft gel has up to 22 times more omega-3 free fatty acids than fish oil and is backed by 30 years of clinical research.
Thanks, Omega XL. I don't have that same pain anymore.
XL Health TT Limited are the sole legal distributors in this country.
Congratulations to the 12 schools that have made it into the playoffs of the 2018 National Word Championship. Now the Trinidad Express newspapers, in partnership with Green Dot Limited, Call Fire, and First Citizens, brings you all the excitement as one of these teams will spell its way to the 2018 title. It's the 2018 National Word Championship, starting in January, only on CCN TV6.
It is is 2019, and there is only one place to be when it comes to sports talk. I-95.5 FM, iSports with the fearless one, Andre Errol Batiste. We talk the talk like no one else. From minister to administrator to sporting personality, they all know nothing but the truth will suffice. iSports on I-95.5 FM. Three times the fun and entertainment. Tuesdays, 7 to 8 p.m. Thursdays and Saturdays, 6:15 to 8 p.m. Listen and have no fear. No fear. Fearless is one man, and one man alone the people trust. I-95.5 is your sporting headquarters in 2019.
The Trinidad Express Newspapers, the most exclusive, crucial, and hard-hitting investigative journalism in TNT since 1967.
National coach Dennis Lawrence was appointed back in January 2017. So far, he's played just around 16 games. He's won 4, drawn 2, and lost 10. He has used approximately 55 players over the course of that time, as he has experimented with different setups and different players, how they fit into the squad. Dennis, when you look at that ratio, football is about results. Are you happy, pleased, satisfied, disappointed with what you've done so far on the field of play?
Obviously, when you look at it from a results point of view, I don't think any coach would be happy with those sort of results, because that's not what you're in the game for. You're in the game to win 16 out of 16. And that remains my challenge. But what I'm happy about is because I know what the process I was working towards and where I'm going and the direction I'm heading. So we look at all those games, and I, at the end of the World Cup campaign, the first thing I identified was that we were conceding too many goals. So then we move forward into 2018, where we had, I think it was 6 friendlies. And then you break it down overall, we lost 3 games, we won 2, and we drew 1. But I look at the bigger picture. We played 6 games, we conceded 3 goals. So that means we conceded less than a goal a game. So my plan is going into motion is that defensively we had to improve. And we improved because prior to that we were conceding too many goals, way too many early in games. And now we've managed to play the likes of Iran in Iran, play Thailand in Thailand, play UAE in Spain, play Martinique in Martinique, play Guadeloupe in Guadeloupe. So that's 5 games on the road. And we've still walked away with 6 games, conceded 3 goals. So that means we're doing something right.
So you are seeing improvement with this team?
Yes, improvement.
Improvement. Now, some may say, and you would have heard the critics over the course of the last few weeks, that they're not happy with Dennis Lawrence. Because as far as they're concerned, and Dennis, their football is about results. Mm-hmm. And while you may be seeing improvements over the course of the year, if it is that Trinidad Tobago is not producing the results that the football fraternity think that we need to be producing, then we look for a new coach, because this coach is not doing what he needs to do. We need to be going out there and winning matches and dominating the Caribbean once again, going into the hex and challenging in a serious way. This coach is not doing that.
The good thing about this is that In many situations, opinions and criticism in my position is welcome. Because why? I believe that it makes you a better coach. You learn from it, and you learn from other people. What I would say, though, is that when you use the word opinion, everyone's entitled to an opinion. even myself. So then you got to be careful that if you live in a glass house, you don't throw stones. Because some of the people give the opinions, they had their opportunity. They had the opportunity in 1994 as coaches the under-20 team. They had the opinion in 1996, coach of the under-20 team.
We're talking Keith Leclerc here.
Well, yeah. I'm just saying.
I'm just going back to that.
You know, people who were in positions, mm-hmm. as I said, and I can continue, under-17 team, assistant coach of the national senior
Keith
team.
Keith has been your biggest critic.
Maybe. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't follow these people because why? I'm interested in work. I'm interested in improvement. But I'm just saying some of the louder voices that had opportunities. Mm-hmm. And when they had up their opportunity, for whatever reason, it failed. So now they move on to another avenue. They're now working in a higher role, I want to say it. And they still have an opinion. But you got to be careful, as I said. If you live in a glass house, then don't throw stones. Because if you don't want to help Dennis Lawrence, then that's fine. I've got no interest in that. You're entitled to your opinion, and I'm entitled to mine.
Let's deal with the results. I mean, you said, of course, you're not satisfied. When you hear the criticisms, whether it's from Mr. Leclerc, who has been very outspoken about this administration, and you came in under the fire for that as well, based on your role as coach, when you hear the criticisms, are the criticisms just in that fair, in that it is probably, we need probably someone with a little more experience. Because right now, trying to make good football is not moving in an upward movement as far as they're concerned. We're not getting the kind of results. This is a less than 50% ratio of positive results. How fair is that? And I mean, you know, the world of football, coaching is a serious business. I mean, coaches go and come as quickly as they come.
Yeah. And I'll make it very clear for you. When I was working in the English Premier League and I moved from Wigan and I went to Everton.
Yeah.
When I went to Everton Football Club, there was every single thing there to win a football game.
Right.
Training facilities, players, you had every single thing as a coach to win a football game.
No excuses.
There is no excuses. When you're working with a football association that the resources are not the same,
yeah.
to be judged on results alone, in my opinion, I think you'll be a bit harsh. But as I go back to saying again, if you look back at some of the people that are doing the criticism, in 2011, when they were the technical advisor and they appointed a coach, and things wasn't going that well. In fact, I would say football was in a better place in Trinidad to be good than it was now. We had a proper league, there was better finances. Now we're struggling. You look at the Pro League started in June last year, all these set of things. And when you look back at that time, the coach was heavily supported. What is the reason? Is it because that the person who appointed the coach had to defend his appointment? Is it because, well, it was a foreigner and we just don't support our own? Those are the questions that these people have to answer. But for me, as I said before, I will welcome criticism, opinions, because I can learn off of it.
Do you feel supported?
I'm supported by the people that I need the support from, without a shadow of a doubt. What I would say is that some of the people who are doing the criticism, in their role, maybe they need to ask themselves, am I doing enough to support our coaches? Because the criticism is not just against Dennis Lawrence, it's been against other coaches as well. So that's maybe the question that needs to be asked.
Mm-hmm. 55 players used over the course of about a year and a half to 2 years kind of thing. Found what you're looking for? I mean, you've used quite a few players. You were very critical, Dennis, I'm recalling, of the standard of the Pro League at this point in time. Found what you're looking for moving forward, if it is we're moving forward? Or are you still searching? Are you still looking for players that will fit that mold in terms of our best 22 players in the country?
No, I think, obviously, in certain positions, mm-hmm. I'm still looking. But I think, as again, if you look back at 2018, if you look at the squad selected for the 6 games, you would find in general the squad was pretty more or less mm-hmm. very consistent mm-hmm. with a couple coming in and out. And that's because, as I said before, prior to that, we were looking for what we wanted. We were looking at all sorts of different things. We were looking at attitude. We were looking at commitment. We were looking at quality. So we've managed now to find a core that I would say, but there's one or two positions, obviously, we would like to improve on. Mm-hmm. So, and don't forget, when I was critical of the Pro League, I was critical of the fact that there was no activity for the players for too long a period. If you look back at 2018, we played Panama, and I had relatively a local squad, apart from Daniel Cyrus and Cole Keito, who were fortunate enough to be here. And me being the brave coach, wanting to help and develop Trinidad and Tobago football, I took a game knowing very well that the local players hadn't played any football from since November the year before. But my interest is to develop the players and to make sure that the players are continuously playing football. So I take the risk. It's not a problem for me. I'm about development and I'm about improving. If I was thinking about the result, when I was asked about the game, I would have said no immediately because I knew it was going to be a challenge. But I'm not thinking about Dennis Lawrence CV. I'm thinking about developing Trinidad and Tobago football and getting the football players on the football pitch.
Where's the weakness? Where does the weakness lie? You're looking for a couple of positions. Where does the weakness lie?
Yeah, obviously, I think we need to improve still in the central striker's position. I think is a position that we've not really found a sturgeon.
Yeah.
And it's something that is crucial in football games. If you don't score goals, you're always on the back foot. So, you know, we're still looking at that area of the pitch. I think defensively in the left fullback position, I think we can find somebody for that position because, you know, we've used Tristan there who's capable. But the reality is I think Tristan is a better centre half. I think he's better in the middle of the park. So we're still looking at those positions.
Dennis Lawrence is here with me tonight as we break it down on halftime. He has been just about 2 years into the job. Is he looking ahead to a long, bright future with Trinidad and Tobago's football? When we come back.
Biofreeze Cold Therapy Pain Relief contains all natural menthol and Ilex, providing pain relief for over 25 years, is now the number one clinically recommended pain relieving gel for arthritis, lower back pain, muscular aches and strains, joint pain. Available in tube, roll-on and spray, Biofreeze Cold Therapy Pain Relief is distributed by AP Scott Trinidad Limited at Pennywise, Superfarm and leading pharmacies.
Trinidad and Tobago Cuba Educational and Cultural Exchange in collaboration with the National Dance Association of Trinidad and Tobago and the San Fernando Arts Council presents Habana Compass Dance, Napa, Friday, January 18th, 2019, Sapa, Sunday, January 20th, 2019. Tickets are available at Napa and Sapa box offices, Athurley's Restaurant and Bar, Sutton Street, San Fernando, Creative Arts Center, 97C Circular Road, San Fernando, Cleves Music, 58 Frederick Street, all cachet and panache locations. Also via Suntex Express and via NLCB Lotto locations nationwide. For info, call 782-9328, 497-6871 or 657-7665.
Excuse me, hello, where? Excuse me, sir.
You dropped this.
Oh, thanks.
With BioStrata food supplements, you stay fit. You know, Rachel, I told you to take a BioStrata, you know. Come on, can't keep up with Granny.
To get ahead, you need more than just practice. You need the Express Tuition Course, a comprehensive coaching tool that gives SEA students the competitive edge in all subject areas. With the Express Tuition Course, you get a practice test based on the current SEA curriculum, a complete marking scheme, and step-by-step solutions allowing you to precisely gauge your progress. Creative writing tips to enhance your work, plus a tuition and revision section to help you stay sharp. So don't just practice. Get ahead with the Express Tuition course. Free every Tuesday in the Trinidad Express newspapers. On every day of the week, the Trinidad Express newspapers means business. In the Daily and Saturday Express, we've dedicated more pages to giving you the financial facts, figures, opinions, and insight you need to give your business the competitive edge. Plus, in the Sunday Express, you get more comprehensive, in-depth coverage with the business story of the week, weekly stock market analysis, and financial planning advice to inform your strategy. So whether you're a budding entrepreneur or the head of a large corporation, you can rest assured that on every day of the week, the Trinidad Express newspapers means business.
Listen for the Sound of the Whistle every Wednesday night. We are back halftime Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. on 6. Dennis Lawrence, it starts things off for 2019 as the football takes a look back at what transpired over the last couple of years. And Coach, do you feel that football fans locally are excited by the national football program? Do you feel like, you know, excited by the national players? Think back when Dennis Lawrence, Dwight York, Stern John, Russell Lackerby. We were excited.
We were excited, yeah. But at what point? Because I could remember for the World Cup qualifying campaign. I could remember playing against Costa Rica as part of one of the games to qualify, and I didn't think I saw
10 people in the crowd.
I didn't see a full stadium.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I think if you need to understand how our people are, and that's how they are, I wouldn't say that they're passionate about sport. Mm-hmm. I think they know how to support when things are going well. And we have to live with that. That's just the way it is. We can't change some of these people. What I would always say is there's always a hardcore football, passionate following. And I always try to appeal to that group of people because we owe it to these people to always maintain a professional approach, to give our all, and to represent well. And we also need to do it for ourselves. So I think the ones who need to be passionate are passionate.
Talk to the critics for a bit. Can Dennis Lawrence take this national team, this national program, to the next level?
Yeah, I believe I can do it. I think it is a hard challenge, but it's a challenge that I'm up for. It's a challenge that if you look at me today, I'm no different from when I came in January 2017. I still have the belief, and I still have the belief in the players. And I believe the only way to get things done is by hard work. sometimes I need to use myself as an example, but I was told when I was 15 years that I wouldn't make it in football, that, you know, football is not for me. And I decided to go a different way and say, the more you said to me that you couldn't make it, is the more I was determined to make it. And that's the philosophy that I've got with this job I'm in at the moment. And my thing is that all the critics who talk, all the people who've got their opinions, I embrace it and I welcome it and I absorb it because it can help me to become a better coach, a better person. I'm still a young coach. Mm-hmm. I'm still a young coach, so I'm still learning. And you learn from everyone every day. Sometimes you go to the supermarket and people give you advice and it becomes good advice. So if you ask me about my belief, oh, definitely. Dennis Jones believes that he can do the job.
Quality of players that you would have played with, even players that you would have probably known before your era, and the quality of players that we have today, how do they put, if you put them on a scale, do we have the type of quality? That's one of the things you hear, that, you know, we don't no longer have that type of quality players that we used to. How are you, as the coach of this bunch of players, respond to that?
The quality, I think we still got equality. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things definitely that helped in my era was the quality of the leagues and the teams the players were playing for. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of us was in the UK at that time. So we were training and I keep saying this to people, when you're in the UK, you don't go to training, you go to work. And you go in there and the training session is demanding. It's concentration. And he had to perform on that level consistently. When you miss that part of it, it's hard to recover just going into an international game. So in terms of the quality, I think we still got quality. We still got players with exceptional quality and talent. I think consistency is where we lack.
At this juncture, out of contract?
At this junction, still in contract. I think I got a few days to go.
A few days to go. Contract negotiations taking place now?
Yes, I had a meeting with the president, and I think from the feedback I got, majority of the board were in favor, but I think the board now need to meet and formalize, and I think that would take its own course. As I said before, I'm a football person and I'm a strong believer, and I'm pretty confident everything will get sorted.
With the rumors that we were hearing that you were heading out, Dennis Lawrence wants to coach this Trinidad Tobago team despite the last 2 years, despite all the challenges, overcoming the hurdles. Dennis Lawrence wants to be in Trinidad Tobago coaching his national team?
Of course. And I said that many years ago, and I repeat it again. One of the things is that I went abroad and I educated myself. Mm-hmm. I spent a long time from 2010 to 2017 trying to obtain my coaching badges. So I spent a long time. And every time I was doing it, the one thing in my head is, one day I'm going to come back and give back to this country that I believe is my country, is my home. I've got British nationality, but you've never heard me say I'm a British citizen, because I'll always be a Trinidadian. So from that point of view, of course, I'm wanting to be here. I've started a process, and I would like to be able to continue it.
I wish you all the best. Let's know how the contract negotiations go, and if we have a national coach in Dennis Lawrence going forward into 2019.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Dennis Lawrence coming in the hot seat tonight, and looking back and looking ahead a bit as to what we can expect. Trinidad Tobago's football continues to be very, very divided. And we hope to see in 2019 at least the majority of the fraternity support football and forget just opposing for opposing sake. I'm Joel Villafano. This was Halftime. Play on. I'll see you back here next week.